All right, you guys are more chatty than my worst students, but that's good. Lively crowd. Well, looks like we got a full room today. And again, I'm delighted to be here. I would like to anticipate that I don't speak Serbian, just a few bad words, in Slovenian, Croatian, and Serbian. I was born around the corner. You remember Trst, Zenaš? Well, I come from that city. My family had properties in Istria and Dalmatia. Originally, my family is from Ragusa, which is the name, the ancient name of Dubrovnik. And then after World War II, we have to find safe haven in Trieste, in Trst. And then from there, I spent all my youth between Trieste and former Yugoslavia, the good old days. You know, you were coming to buy stuff in my city, and we were going on vacation. Your lad was absolutely heaven. So I have a wonderful youth. Thank you to my hometown. Thank you to you guys that were, you know, had a very interesting financial system. So was a win-win situation. And I feel culturally totally connected with the Balkans. I mean, my family, there are many Balkanians. I got two Slovenian grandmothers. I have definitely probably someone that come from the south of the Balkans. And then my grandfather in the mid-late 1800 came from Budapest to Trieste. So he had 18 kids, so it's you know. And if you check the geography, the type of land, starting from Monfalcone to Trieste and coming down to Belgrade, is pretty much the same. The same trees, the same animals, the same type of land, and the same food, and the same dialect. And in the past, we are part of the old Austro-Hungarian Empire that made us all very similar. Probably the first real European community that that was created in this continent. I would like to give you a little introduction about who I am scientifically, where I am now, which is also the place where Professor Langer has been working in the last few years. And after this, there will be a few presentations about equine neuropathology, equine herpes virus 1, pathogenesis and lesions, everything you want to know as a pathologist or as a veterinary infectious disease specialist. Then we talk about the remaining viral diseases in addition to EHV1, there are quite a few. And then there will be an afternoon dedicated to, if I remember the schedule, dedicated to bovine pathology, particularly respiratory diseases, intestinal diseases. I anticipate that regarding domestic animals and sylvatic species, I pretty much have got a huge collection, thousands of slides, dozens of presentations. So if you want to have more in the future, recorded on the C.L. Davis Foundation site, or right here, I will be totally happy to deliver it. I go to visit my hometown 2-3 times per year. So for me to grab a bus in Trieste and drive down here or any part of the Balkans to give as much as you want, for me is a real pleasure. I'm at this stage of my career that I got quite a few publications, I'm full professor tenure. I got 4 books, 2 are actually on equine pathology, 1 equine pathology, 1 bovine pathology coming out, so you can find all this material there for a very reasonable price. So for me, it's always a privilege and a pleasure to come to lecture in Europe. So I'm sitting here, I'm not walking around the room as I generally like to do, because we are recording this, and we like to have the audio, the voice, you know, understandable in our recording. So let's start to talk about our institution. And if something is missing in your handouts, like I heard that the Equine Neuropathology digital handout is not available, I can shoot it again via email to your supervisor here, and then they can be distributed. Since I'm not providing the presentations, because that's my stuff that make me travel and famous, and I'm not sharing, I prepare some handouts where you can, at home, you can pretty much, review all this data. But my suggestion would be that you just relax. Don't relax too much, just the right relaxation. And then you just follow the slides. My motto is the same motto of my mentor, one of my mentors, probably the most loved mentor in the United States, Professor John King, that a picture worth a thousand words. So not much written sentences in my presentation, but the real stuff. It's all my material. When there is something that doesn't belong to me, I acknowledge it, slide by slide. If I miss some acknowledgement, I apologize for this moment. It's possible. And when my friends give me something that I don't have, I like to acknowledge it on the slide. Okay, so let's see what we do in Lousiana quickly, very quickly. So here I'm definitely representing, well, my institution. Then we are here because of the C.L. Davis Foundation decided to have this course. That's a continuing education organization which gathers many pathologists, and our goal is to pretty much deliver what we have. Is a non-profit. We don't get a penny for what we do. Actually, often we lose money from our pocket. And then the American College of Veterinary Pathologists, and the mission of the college, as the mission of all the pathologists in the United States from the beginning, is to teach, so to communicate the knowledge, to serve, which means to serve the community with diagnostics and opinion, and then to do research. We're in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and where is this? Okay, United States, DC, the South, from Florida, Gulf of Mexico, great place to be, fishing is fantastic. And then here is Louisiana. And then if we move here, New Orleans would be north of this second map. And then here is the Mississippi Delta, which brings all these fantastic nutrients to the Gulf of Mexico that make it so you can fish as well as you fish in Dalmatia, just to give an example. And then along the river, along the Mississippi River, right here, is right here, 100 miles from the from the coast, is Baton Rouge. Baton Rouge, red stick, because the first time that the French coming down to the Mississippi saw in that area was a little opening with a red stick where the Native American were skinning the animals. It was red, painted red, or maybe red of the blood. And Baton Rouge, French, you can detect the strong French Acadian influence of the area. It's a very particular area which has got lots of European influence and also lots of Native American influence. And near the Mississippi here, with the barges you can see, here is the vet school and the diagnostic laboratory where we also are. So it's we are located really on the river. So with a few hundred yards, you can come over here, you can start fishing. It's absolutely a gifted location. And that's a part of the campus. So moving from here, you can walk through Skip Bourbon Drive coming here, and there is the stadium of the LSU football team and others that can hold 100,000 people. And then the campus. The university was founded around the years of the Civil War in the 1800s, and then progressively expanded. And then the lakes, which here there was a swamp in the past, they've been, in the 1930s, the swamp has been dried up and the lakes have been built, formed. We have all these trees that you see are live oaks, beautiful, large trees, which are the American cousin of our lecho here on the Mediterranean, the classic Quercus ilex that you see along your Balkanian coast. Sport is huge in Louisiana, particularly football. That's a classic football game. Almost every game, the stadium is full. Team is very good. See the band that is forming the LSU initials, singing, playing, and marching around. So that's a moment of one hour game, a picture which is particularly significant. Lots of strength and energy. Our mascot is a tiger. These are all rescue animals. So they're not animals being captured and put in a cage. Actually, the enclosure that this animal has, you know, I would like to live there personally and have the tiger live in my house, because this animal kept so well. Actually, Harvey is a recent mascot. Now he's still here. A baby, was 9 months old. Now he's, you know, grew up quite a bit. Mike was the, now he's, Harvey was the original name. Now it's called Mike, because the official name of our mascot is Mike. It is the School of Veterinary Medicine that was been built in the 70s, and here near the river, in this semi-aerial view. And attached is a rather recent diagnostic laboratory with offices, laboratories, the study in the back, a very nice and efficient necropsy room, a very strong group of pathologists. The director is also a pathologist, and we have several laboratories, serology, molecular biology, bacteriology, an anti-doping center, fish infectious disease pathologist, very, with Dr. Hawk, very strong program, all under the same roof. And just to show you what we roughly do, probably the conversion of the presentation is not ideal. See, this is the picture covering a little bit the letters, so when you move from computer to computer, this thing happens, but probably no big deal. You see, we look at conventional species like cats and dogs and horses and ruminants and the production animals. At the same time, we are very connected with the community in rescuing the animal during the flooding, you know, subtropical area, lots of rain, occasional severe flooding, hurricanes, the last one, Katrina, and Harvey, and another hurricane that was pretty destructive. In the most recent year, not much, except a flood in 2016. And also, this sort of gave me an opportunity to show you how close we are to the community. That's an open house where 6,000 to 8,000 people visit our university. They visit actually our vet school, and they can have hands-on. You see the children get exposed to horse anatomy. And we have a very strong special species group. This is the rehabilitation of a bald eagle released by Dr. Nevarez and Dr. Brandao. And we have many alligators that are bred for reintroduction in the wild. We have millions of alligators, probably more alligators than people, and some are used then to produce skin and meat. 50% of the eggs of the hatchlings go after being raised to the wild, and the other 50% goes to the farms, and also lots of catfish production. That's a bullhead. It's not the type of catfish that you generally eat, but a good example to show you how catfish look like, right? A very smart fish, by the way. Found in 1968, we graduated many people. The Department of Pathobiological Sciences in the School of Veterinary Medicine is currently ranked number one in research for the PDLSU, so we push out lots of papers, and our colleagues get quite a few millions for research. We are one of the only three schools to offer treatment for kidney failures in animals or hemodialysis, and one of the only two to offer renal replacement therapy. 100 faculty member, the student body is 335 veterinary student, 60 graduate student. We see more than 23,000 cases each year, 6,000 special species, which means everything that is not conventional domestic animals. You graduate many people, large number of women, and we produce many PhD and master degrees. What I'm gonna show in my presentations is just the tip of the iceberg. I mean, what I'm gonna show you here in this brief introduction, and in the next equine viral diseases and bovine presentation, is just a little bit, or we can discuss in the future together. Because the collection we have is pretty much immense. Thank you to my previous mentor and our busy activity. We are all board certified pathologists, So we all took our exam in Emsawa, Iowa. Now it's relocated, where we took our exam to become board certified pathologists, which is a process like the European College that takes quite a lot of sweat and blood, and there's a tough exam at the end. We do in our activity necropsies, histology, histochemistry, indirect immunohistochemistry, inside hybridization, and everything gets matched with ancillary microbiological procedures. The nice thing in the United States, especially in a diagnostic laboratory associated to a vet school and associated to a university, is that the pathologist, and that's different from the European system, let's say Europe, I mean generally Central, Southern Europe, the EU people, that the pathologist is the case coordinator. So it's not that the case goes to a bacteriologist, goes to a guy that read, or to a pathologist who read the slides, and everything is dissected and prosected by a veterinarian, which is, I'm sure is good, but is not specialized in pathology. We do the necropsy. We read the slides. We send out the report. I decide which kind of specimens go to virology, to bacteriology, to mycology, to molecular biology. So the ACVP, board certified pathologist, or the ECVP, board certified pathology, is the person that decides where the samples go and eventually put the signature on the report. So that's very important because there is no dispersion of efforts. It's a system that I always suggest to my European friends and colleagues to adopt, but it's not always like this. Just to tell you how things work, and they've been working fine for many, many years. Necropsy room, see, with the two coolers, ample area to bring in the tables for large animal dissections or small animals. Easy to address, easy to wash. That's my previous necropsy room, but just pretty much how busy we can be. Two horses, a small ruminant, two seals. These were seals from the Atlantic coast when I was at University of Pennsylvania. Again, a room that was smaller, but as efficient as our large room. Just to show you the capability we have to approach multiple species. Comparative pathology covers them all. That's a swimming dog. The lesion, the anatomy will be similar, and the diseases will be kind of similar with some differences. So don't be afraid to approach multiple species. Then, you know, we can we do a lot of comparative pathology, classic salmonellosis in a horse, classic salmonellosis in a pig, and classic salmonellosis in an alligator. Comparative pathology covers them all. Same gross lesion, same histologic lesion, same type of additional investigation. Then we take care of animal health. For instance, we get here, we diagnose within one day a very important outbreak around Christmas or a few years ago of bronchopneumonia in dogs, Streptococcus epidemicus, very aggressive diagnostic service. Our storage area, show you, you know, these are the cases of pretty much a couple of weeks, necropsies. Don't show you the biopsy because they would fall out of the screen. And our treatment room, which communicate directly with the necropsy room. Someone of you want to come over, visit us, and take a look. You know, we'll be glad to assist you. Tissue preparation, you know them all, you know. This tissue's been diagnosed the following day. So we put a rash, we can diagnose outbreak infection very quickly. Histology, classic equipment in histology. And then, I always like to show this picture. When I was my final year at the vet school in Milan, I found on the wall of the metro in Milan this poster. It was written, cancer kill you, we kill cancer, or research kills cancer. So I took the picture, photoshopped a little bit, very old picture, 1985 from Kodafone. Infection cancer kill us, our research kills infection cancer. We got couple machines for indirect immunohistochemistry and one for inside hybridization. That's run quite a bit because we got investigators that want to collaborate with us and vice versa. And what you do with immuno, we do detect viruses, bacteria, protozoa, fungi, cell markers, hormones, and pretty much any protein, as you know. I saw your nice poster outside of immuno, very nice preparations, congratulations. A few examples: listeriosis in the portal area of a newborn kid, neospora, cyst and zoites in the skin of an immunosuppressed dog, had renal transplantation, and then put under cyclophosphamide and corticosteroids, histones in the villus of a piglet, a C-kit to detect mast cells in a round cell tumor, and then in the middle, hysterical encephalitis, a disease we don't have in Europe, thanks God. We have other horrible things, but not triple E, and in a pheasants that underline the Purkinje cells. It's a disease that we'll consider during my equine neuropathology presentation. And in collaboration with Professor Kupel of Michigan State University, one of the best pathologists of our college, with Dr. Langer and a few others, a dual identification, the identification with insetoberization of the RNA virus of triple E in the brain of a deer, and then in the background, the detection of the protein. So double staining. It's a nice collaboration we had with Professor Kupel a few years ago on triple E in deer. We love to study zoonotic diseases because it bridges the field with human medicine and what the population really needs. And actually, I feel particularly useful when I'm able to diagnose something that affects animals and humans at the same time. It can contribute to the well-being of both world. Classic a study on a model of black plague with Dr. Schifferli when I was at the University of Pennsylvania. Classic papilloma with detection of the bacteria within the lesion. Research activities, so summarizing, experimental disease, so a strong foot in basic science, and then diagnosis discovery of new natural diseases. The nicest thing, I love to be on duty on necropsy, like all of you, I'm sure, and pretty much what will come through your door that day, nobody knows. It's like Christmas. It's like waiting, you know, for St. Nicholas, not Santa. St. Nicholas, tall, middle European, skinny, strong, not round. So it's like waiting for Christmas, for your Christmas gift. What will come through the door? Bunch of horses, cattle, alligators, cats and dogs, llamas, alpacas, pigs. When you get a pig in Louisiana, we get sporadically, but they're loaded with diseases. Ask Dr. Langer, the pig she had pretty much any possible infectious disease she saw in up north. So it's great to be able to publish on natural diseases. No experiment necessary, just you, your knowledge, your reagents, collaboration with clinician, and animal that dies spontaneously, because that's life, that's death. All right. After this brief from a Mediterranean point of view introduction, and I see nobody sleeping yet, so that's a success. We can go to the first presentation. So you see, equine neuropathology, equine herpes viruses, equine viral diseases minus herpes and minus the neurologic diseases we'll discuss in the neuropathology talk. Bovine respiratory pathology of cattle, and then bovine intestinal pathology. And then the organizer of the symposium, please stop me when necessary for the breaks. All this material is in our books that we published recently again. Equine pathology of Klaus Burgelt, and from University of Florida, but born in Hanover, and myself. And then the other book is bovine pathology, Burgelt, again Florida, Clark, Canada, and then Del Piero, Trieste LSU. No Americans in our book. Yes, we have Americans. We have in the chapter, we have quite a few Americans. Neuropathology courses, full screen. All right, I hope the light is sufficient. See, the audio should be sufficient since I'm close to the camera. Anybody recognize the artist here? By the way, that's me going to ask for a raise to my chairman. You're supposed to laugh at my joke. Don't be shy in Balkanian. Anybody recognize this beautiful painting? Italian-American artist that like to paint mythological creatures, warriors. Frazetta, if anybody belongs to my generation, pretty much an icon during the late 70s and 80s about making this beautiful drawing. So that's, I'd like to honor Maestro Frazetta from Pennsylvania for his wonderful work, and I would like to introduce this neuropathology of horses talk. Let's talk with Byron Cephalomyelitis. Rabies, rhabdovirus, lissaviride, is a polyencephalomyelitis with ganglionitis. Very good picture of Professor John King, I think he got it from South Africa, of a classic case of rabies in a carnivore. In a horse, we should put a horse that is, you know, depressed or very aggressive. We have both cases. Sometimes you cannot euthanize the horse because it's too aggressive. There are some cases in which the owner shot the horse in the chest because couldn't go close to the horse. And then other cases where the animal is really depressed, very much so. Classic morphology of the virus with a rectal microscopy, bullet shape, you know. And it's amazing. Rabies virus and vesicular stomatitis, both same morphology, same lissaviride with this shape, and then, you know, one induced encephalomyelitis, severe, fatal. The other one just induced disease of the skin and the foot. Everything is summarized. Each disease I could speak for hours. But just I want to show you the key features of each disease from a pathological and an infectious disease specialist point of view. What you see in these horses? Well, rarely, you see nothing. What do you mean nothing? You see no inflammation. Rarely, but it happened. In 1990, in Milan, my professor showed me a slide of a dog that was imported from Africa, and this dog started acting funny, had some traumatic seizure, was euthanized, and that slide had no one inflammatory cell. But there were negative bodies all over the slide. So occasionally, you don't see this inflammation, but it's frequently present. And so these inflammatory cells are comprised of lymphocytes, small lymphocytes, and a few macrophages. Plasma cells, I say it from the beginning, are not a feature, generally, of viral diseases of the horse CNS. Rabies in sheep, goats, and cattle, and viral encephalomyelitis in ruminants will have some plasma cells. In horses, they are not generally a feature. You have T cells, generally CD8 small T lymphocytes, and a few macrophages. Then, in the Purkinje cells, but also in cortical neurons, especially the animal was not euthanized but went very close to his demise after a prolonged clinical presentation. That shouldn't happen because you're supposed to euthanize this animal to spare them some suffering. Intracytoplasmic, red, pink inclusion, negri bodies. You know, they're called negri bodies, but Dr. Negri many years ago was misled. So it was another guy, I forgot the name, that identified these nuclear inclusions connected with the infection. And then, if you collect the trigeminal ganglion in your cases, as I always do, is a collection that is not particularly rewarding, but it is in diseases like rabies, borna, and rarely others. You can see a ganglionitis. This is a morphologically normal neuron. You can here see an episode of cellular violence. Here there are some satellite cells that are forming this satellitosis on this neuron that is degenerate, going toward necrosis. And these spaces are where the neurons are now gone, are totally occupied by satellite cells and macrophages, and these bodies are called Najok bodies. So what's left of the neuron in this case, these phagocytes, this aggregation is called Najok body. So neuron, satellitosis, neuronophagia, synonymous, and then Najok bodies. These are the histologic lesions already. Histologically, you understand how the virus was in perfect balance with several vertebrates for many, many years. Very ancient virus. You can see that I like to say that there is more virus than brain. You can find the virus not in the astrocytes, but plenty within the cytoplasm and the extensions of neurons. See, very easy diagnosis. Why do we have such a rudimentary diagnosis like FA for such an important disease? Because there is more virus than brain. You take it's a fast diagnosis. You take a piece of brain, make a smear, and then fix it in alcohol, I think, and then do FA. You cannot do that with Western virus, where there is one positive cells every 10 slides. But with rabies, it's FA is still the official test. And it should be, because it's fast, inexpensive, and there is lots of virus there. Sometimes in the basal nuclei you find neurons that are morphologically normal. I swear this neuron with HNE didn't have much. And then look at with immunohistochemistry. You start seeing some gliosis, which is not so evident, I don't know why, with the original HNE slides, probably I sectioned deeply, so I was able to identify this gliosis. And look at the virus factories here and the diffuse staining of the cytoplasm with the nerve fibers. So very easy diagnosis. Immunohistochemistry is not an official technique, but it's great to have in your in your freezer. You have these antibodies. So in case you get a brain in formalin where FA is not possible anymore, you can do PCR, some institution can do that, or you can do it in direct immunohistochemistry. Great tool to have. Purkinje cells, and then the efferent fibers, interestingly, granular layer with a few positive cells. So very easy diagnosis with FA and immunohistochemistry. Some people do virus isolation to produce virus bands. I remember when I was talking in 1988 at the Dubai meeting of equine infectious diseases with a colleague from South Africa. They also do isolation because they want to keep the virus bands. And these are cerebellum, look at the foliar. And this is not background staining, this is all good stuff. All right? So this is all positive staining. Look at how much virus there is in this foliar. And the dots are the positive Purkinje cells. And this looks like rather pale. Well, there is also virus here, but not as much as here. So that's the reason, because several SOP about biosecurity don't allow you to use the bandsaw to remove the brain of the rabies suspect, because you could create an aerosol. I personally think it's more dangerous to use your handsaw to pull out the brain. I would prefer to go there with a mask and split the head, but that's the reason, because some SOPs don't allow you to be fast and efficient with the bandsaw. Bandsaw is something you're using at the stage all the time, pretty much a big machine with a running blade. The one that you see in the fish markets, like in Milan, or you've got a big fish market on the Dalmatian coast, to cut tuna and swordfish, well, we use it for bones and spinal cords, vertebral columns. All right. Antigen within the Purkinje cells, look at the virus factories. You see there is no correlation between negri bodies and virus factories, different location, different histochemistry. Like a little bit, we can distemper in dogs, you know. Some inclusions are not necessarily comprised of virus, especially the intranuclear inclusion. They are mainly comprised of Hitchcock protein, and so there is no correlation here necessary between the histochemical inclusion with the immunohistochemical inclusion. And that's a ganglion. So the rabies virus love to infect the ganglia. You can see this the fifth nerve with the fiber, all expressing the virus. I hate the term positive that everybody uses. Positive four. Expressing, present. Positive is positive, a state of mind for me. Use positive, it's fine, it's acceptable. This neuro with a vacuolization. Be careful, vacuolization in ganglia could be the cytopathic effect of rabies virus. There is a paper, there is a manuscript of veterinary pathology of the early 90s where they describe a bovine case with lots of vacuolations. But also, vacuoles, as Professor Cummings, one of my mentors at the university, said, vacuoles in neurons could be just an incidental finding. So, and they don't mean necessarily a prion disease. Then an adult body with all these poor phagocytes loaded with rabies virus, and then multiple neurons with the virus. Amazing, huh? So all my career from 1985, even as a student until now, I collect trigeminal ganglia from each animal I examine, almost. Autolyzed animal hit by car, well, sometimes, yes. But in horses, they're very easy. Pretty much you open the head, or you split in the middle, or you use your three cuts that are suggested on Professor John King's book. And then as you remove the brain, you go to see the pituitary gland, and on the both sides, with the tip of your knife, you can scoop the ganglia out. If the animal is older, meninges are a little bit ossified, but it's a very easy procedure. And it's easily recognizable because it's shaped like a lollipop, where the tip of the lollipop are the neural cells. And grossly, you can see that they're yellowish, grayish, so you know where your ganglia is. Don't see much, but it's nice to add it to the report, you know? When you send out the report, that is everything. Even the celiac mesenteric ganglion in England for dysautonomia, which, you know, it's nice to have it on the report, you know? When the owner of the vet, trigeminal ganglia, celiac mesenteric ganglion, it's good to show you that you know your stuff. And then, in one of the horses that I retrospectively examined at Cornell University in the mid-90s, and there was also some eyes available, so I started looking at the cornea, didn't find much in the cornea, like published in the 70s for human rabies, but which doesn't exclude the presence of the antigen in the cornea. Look at the ganglion cells in the retina, in these fibers. Multiple virus factories. So you got an eye, you can diagnose rabies. Negative doesn't mean negative, positive means a positive. And then in one of the best neuropathologists, now author of the Japanese chapter on neuropathology, actually is in Italy, in Tuscany, in Pisa, Professor Carlo Cantile. And Carlo, in addition to be a great guy and a great vet and pathologist and a great chess player, he's also makes great scheme and drawings. It is one of his scheme of virus distribution that he made, time flies, 1998, when we studied together West Nile virus for the first time. You can see that the virus is pretty much all over the place. It's an encephalo. Is a polio encephalo myelitis and ganglionitis, but it doesn't mean that you don't find the virus in the white matter. We call it polyencephalo myelitis because there is so much virus in the gray matter, but you know there is quite a few bit of virus in the white matter. So distribution all over the place. If this would be Western virus, would be only the brainstem. Rabies all over. Like Easter Equine encephalitis. And then cross section, you see? Gray matter, fish on the left, fish on the right. So, pretty much one, we collect multiple specimens, but generally one sample is sufficient. It's not legit to get only one sample, because the SOP says you need to collect, you know, cerebellum, pons, and then cortex bilaterally, because there are a few papers that say that, oh, well, that was a focal case of rabies. Okay. But in reality, easy to diagnose with FAs. And do histology. Anytime you have a neurologic animal, if you love your job, you love the owner, that animal, and the community, if you get a case of neurologic disease that get diagnosed with rabies, you know, when you collect your fresh specimens before diagnosis, put them informally, follow up with morphology. And if there is a neurologic case that is negative for rabies, even if the owner or the your service, your official veterinarian cares only about that diagnosis of rabies, still drop part informally and follow up with histopathology. You'll diagnose a plethora of very interesting diseases and sometimes something new, especially now that in the Balkans and middle Europa we got, you know, interesting diseases like tick-borne encephalitis. There are so many interesting things to diagnose there. So do your histology, it's great. And as I mentioned before, we can do a lot from the paraffin blocks. Now the paraffin block is the new specimen that is fixed and safe, which is even better of the old specimen that we are keeping in the freezer for further study. The paraffin block is the new thing to have. Distribution of a few diseases. West Nile virus, it was discovered in Uganda in the 30s, was studied by the French. In 1998, it decided to come up from the Italian peninsula, as probably it did every year, through migratory birds, and induce an outbreak of neurologic disease in Padula di Fucecchio, near Pisa. So my colleague Carlo Cantile jumped on those horses, published a good paper on Equine Veterinary Journal. When at the CV meeting, I mentioned to a few colleagues about West Nile virus, and the only guy that knew about it was, of course, Brian Summers, and his, which put three lines of the disease in his wonderful neuropathology book. And then the following years, what's happened in the United States, bang, West Nile virus jumped on the Bronx Zoo and a few elderly people in the United States. And from here, from the East Coast, in 3 years, moved to California. And at the same time, so we started diagnosis West Nile virus in horses late 99 and 2000. I was lucky because nobody wanted to touch the horses. But thanks to Carlo's original work and to the old paper from the French, I knew that was a disease that was not like rabies. There was less virus than, and a lot of inflammation compared to the virus quantity. And then from in 2005, I helped the Argentinians, my friends down to Buenos Aires, Leonardo Minatel, to diagnose in Argentina because the virus went up to Canada and then down Central America and then Argentina and other countries. So from a restricted location in Africa and going up and down the Italian peninsula, this virus most likely came from the Middle East, maybe with some birds or maybe some viremic older guy. And so that's the distribution now. I assume you have West Nile virus in the Balkans. I don't know what your diagnostics are, but there are not many wetlands here, but it would be an area that I'm sure is a good place for the virus. It is in Russia, it is in other Eastern European countries. And then it's a virus that likes particularly birds, transmitted by mosquitoes. It's not a very specific virus, doesn't have only a vector, like hysteric encephalitis, and that's explained the distribution. So some people say that it's a virus that is transported by Catholic feeding mosquito. Catholic intending from a scientific point of view that it pretty much bites anybody. It's a very spread population. So talk about Western virus and then Eastern and Western encephalitis. Western, we don't see it much. I think in the last 25 years were very few cases. And you see the difference. Western equencephalitis and Eastern equencephalitis, they got such a segmental specific distribution because they belong to specific vectors. So West Nile use all the mosquito species, Cules, Aedes, I assume Anopheles, I'm not an entomologist, but you know, lots of vectors. Western, I don't remember which kind of vector it has, but a specific mosquitoes type of insect, and Eastern encephalitis, which starts in the Michigan area here in north, come down on the east coast, very related to the base areas, so it's along the coast truly. For instance, when I was in Pennsylvania, I had a few cases, but the majority of cases I was getting were from New Jersey toward the coast. Come down, Florida is heaven for the disease. Great. Florida is heaven for arboviruses. West Nile, East encephalitis, great place to study diseases. In fact, I got several specimens on Klasburgel from the University of Florida. And then falls up all the southern state. Goes to Arkansas, so goes here as well, and then stops. And the vector is Culizeta melanura, which is a very specific mosquito type of vector, and a few others. And then we are always concerned about Venezuelan equine encephalitis, which is, we have the vector, very old map, maybe it's larger, maybe it's smaller now. We have the vector, but we try to keep the disease out of the country. There is vaccination for all these diseases. Flaviviridae, so Western virus, flavivirus of the Japanese group. You know, there are many flavivirus that you know, yellow fever, tick-borne, Rio Bravo, dengue, dengue, very important disease. So Japanese, St. Louis, so the Japanese group, there is West Nile, Uzutu in Europe, but only birds, crows. St. Louis, very important in people. At the beginning, they thought that West Nile in the United States was St. Louis. Kunjin, very important in Australia. Japanese is scary disease. It's a real important zoonotic disease of Asia. I can handle a mosquito bite with West Nile. I would be horribly afraid to get injected by Culizeta melanura with Eastern encephalitis to go wipes out your brain. But Japanese is also a very concerning disease. There are many cases. If you have problem, you know, every few weeks there is a case of Japanese. And I've been updating this map during the years. And you see, that's the old distribution in blue, and then it came to the United States. Well, sorry, North America, not United States only, because mosquitoes don't look at borders. And then went down south and up North America. And then here's an area where there is both West Nile and Japanese here. Moray Valley encephalitis, right here, which is probably the Australian West Nile, very close to each other. In reality, distribution is more ample, and then probably the map should go northern in Russia. And keep an eye on the tick-borne, because the tick-borne is right here, you know? It goes like this, which is, we'll say a few words. Western flavivirus, flaviviridae, is a polio-rhomboencephalomyelitis in mammals, systemic infection in birds. So, us, as humans, primates, and other domestic animals, higher vertebrates, are dead hands. You know, Vicolo Cecco, last close under construction highway of this disease. Little virus can induce lots of inflammation. Birds pretty much are in balance with the disease. Then some species are very sensitive, like the crows. And then I remember collecting crows falling from the trees near my lab in Pennsylvania. And then there are some or small songbirds. And there are some animals that could, some birds that could care less. Chickens don't get it, but they seroconvert. And so there is variation there. Classic mosquito feeding the virus, which at the electron microscopy is a flavi. It looks like dengue, yellow fever at the electron microscopy. And that's the first course I examined with Western virus. Was late 99, or maybe August 2000. partially fixed. See the brainstem and brainstem and spinal cord, severe hemorrhages. Are hemorrhages suggestive of West Nile virus? Yes, but they are also suggestive of, anybody would like to mention another disease that could have this appearance? Can rabies be associated with hemorrhages? Yes or no? Yes, rarely. Mild, generally. Can hysteric encephalitis be associated with these hemorrhages? Yes. Can equine herpes virus 1 be associated with multiple hemorrhages? Yes, but generally not in the gray matter, but sometimes it does. Can this be a non-viral disease? Would you like to mention a non-viral disease that causes lesions like this one? Sarcocystis neurona. And you know where I saw my first case of sarcocystis neurona? New Market, 1992, in a horse imported from the United States. A beautiful three-year-old horse that, and I have the brain. So lesions like this, very good. More, same case. And then, occasionally, you know, you violate the protocol, went to prescription, so nobody can blame you for doing that. It was ages ago. And so sometimes you are in a rush and you try to remove the spinal cord, and instead of doing a good job because you're in a rush, you hit the spinal cord in the middle. But in this case, it was a blessing because it gave me the opportunity to get a very nice picture of the distribution of the lesions. You see, there is hemorrhage in the white matter, but look at the gray matter. And that's probably the cervical or thoracic portion, generally the cervical area is particularly affected, and the whole gray matter hemorrhagic. And this, in this case, West Nile virus, which was present in very small quantity in this section, behaved like his cousin, the hemorrhagic fever, the dengue, where it's associated with severe vascular leakage and lots of hemorrhage. Interesting presentation. So lucky shot. Histologically, if you are lucky, very few cases. Picture of took together with my colleague Carlo Cantile in 2000. You see some neurons have chromatolysis, but it's not frequent. Then when you see chromatolysis, think about degenerative disease like equine motor neuron disease, but immediately goes to viral diseases. And then satellitosis with chromatolysis. In this slide, we gather pretty much all the histopathologic changes you generally see in 10 horses that you examine, then put together to get all these things. But in this Tuscany horse, we found quite a bit. And then perivascular infiltrate, lymphocytes, macrophages, no plasma cells. You remember what I told you about horses, virus and plasma cells? And then we took this close-up, ring hemorrhages, which are non-specific, and then lymphocytes, and we administered a little bit of apoptosis, and then you can find a few neutrophils here and there, rarely, not as many as with hysteric encephalitis, and then immunohistochemistry is difficult because to find the neurons generally takes 7, 8, 10, 12 sections. So we soon realized that to study the pathogen in the virus was not so easy. And if you have a negative virus isolation, which is common, and if you have even a negative PCR, you want to go to your paraffin block and look for areas where there are glial nodules, because the virus will be in these Gitter cells, in these clusters. Then if you're lucky, you find a neuron containing the virus with a little bit of gliosis. And generally, you see a spheroid there with the antigen. You find a cross-section of a fiber there. So like with EHV1 infection, not much viral antigen there. More, see little inflammation, then a spheroid, a serpiginous spheroid, distribution of the virus. The original work had 50% negative because they were collecting cortex, and the virus, West Nile virus, at least the virus I study, the virus that came to the United States in 98, does in the horse doesn't like to go to the cortex, doesn't like the cerebellum. There will be exceptions, okay? And then love the brainstem. And then the spinal cord, generally lower gray matter. In birds that obviously are more permissive hosts, it looks like parvovirus. Crypt, which are harboring plenty of West Nile virus, a little bit of inflammation. Grossly often you see the gut, which is bloody, containing blood, almost like a clostridiosis, almost like or melena, like a dog with shock, something like this. And then in this cerebellum, you can see that this is not a stain for neurons. This is not a neuron-specific enolase. This is West Nile virus stain. Body, dendrites, fibers. So in birds, it's very easy to diagnose it with immunohistochemistry. And the specimen I suggest you to test with PCR or immunohistochemistry in birds, especially during the hot months of the year, like August, depends when the summer hits it here, whether it's humid. Collect all his brain, spleen, intestine, and then pancreas work. So always pull a few. Remember that vaccinated horses, there is a vaccine, works very well, will not express IgM, express IgG, so that's a gift that we have diagnostically. Instead, a recent infection will express IgM. So you've got a horse, and the horse is febrile, it starts getting neurologic. If you examine the serum, if you got IgM against West Nile virus, it's a significant finding. IgG could be vaccination. If you didn't vaccinate the horse, IgG means exposure anyway. And that's the diagnostic procedure in humans, horses, and birds, if you want. We've been old PCR from Dr. Tawari from Diagnostic Laboratory in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, but we started using it very early, so it's still work. PCR is a great technique. Make sure there is a pathologist collecting specimens so they know what to send. Again, don't send the cortex, send brainstem. Brainstem is a fantastic specimen for histopathology of infectious disease of the CNS, for immunohistochemistry, PCR, and virus isolation. The brainstem is a great specimen. If you don't want to open the head, I hope you are not in such a pathetic situation. If you have one of those BSC type of knife scoop, you can go in and then you can cut it out and examine only the brainstem if you are desperate. I mean, everybody know here how to cut a head open and do the rest. So so that would be the way to go. And regarding biosecurity, I am more concerned about handling a placenta or a small ruminant that could have all those diseases you know very well, including coxiella, than to handle a brain with West Nile virus or even rabies or Eastern encephalitis. So if you use just plastic gloves, it's difficult to catch it. So always use by your biosecurity, but I found personally that they're not too difficult to handle. Birds, totally different music. You saw the birds, there is virus all over the place, so even around the cloaca, so anytime you handle a bird with West Nile virus, you have a lot of virus in that animal. About handling of rabies, we didn't find rabies in the skin of the horses I examined, but remember that in foxes and skunks, we don't have skunks here in in Europe, but we have foxes, the virus can be present in the skin. So I think it's pretty remote that you get rabies handling a fox touching the skin. Probably may get it just cutting yourself with canine teeth and maybe get inoculated, or from a cat that maybe has got the virus on the paws, you get scratched. But remember that in carnivores, there is the possibility to have moderate quantity of viruses in the adnexa. There is a nice paper of the late 80s on veterinary pathology that showed this. So just an additional thing about the rabies distribution in carnivores, not in herbivores. And then, now we go all PCR, but this was the period of time in which our virology colleagues were trying to identify West Nile virus with conventional virus isolation. And as usual, Vero cells, African green monkey cells, works pretty well. It is a nice, intracytoplasmic detection of these Vero cells. But it's not so easy, and then now with PCR we got everything. So classic equine neurologic case we received these days. We received a horse, neurologic horse, acutely. Oh well, we don't touch it. It would be safe to do it. But we are students, we are residents, we are getting old, we're gonna enjoy the Dalmatian coast in a few years for retirement, you know. So we decapitate the animals, open up the cranial cavity with using biosecurity procedures, collect the brain, and we send it for rabies. But at the same time, we ask our molecular biology specialist also to test it for equine herpes virus 1, West Nile virus, Easter equine encephalitis. Then when everything is negative, we go back to the carcass, the body, the following day possibly, we finish the necropsy, and we find something else. We find protozoal, bacterial meningoencephalitis, rare, or Taylor's disease, only with brain edema. So that would be the procedure. So pretty much within one day, or even less, we have a diagnosis of rabies yes, rabies no, for our clinicians and the other people. And then the following day, we have a diagnosis of other viral disease yes or no for the same people. So it works like a charm. Then if you have a diagnosis, you're gonna continue your case on your own to see where the virus is, you can do it. But since we pretty much publish the majority of the data about these things, then you can toss the animal, you destroy it. And we have an incinerator and a digester for that. Other neuronotropic flaviviruses. It doesn't mean that they're less important, because in Europe, some of these viruses, and in Australia, are very important. Laughing eel. For instance, for my Scottish, Irish, and generally British Islands friends, Laughing Eel is an important disease. Great paper of Peter Timoney, best equine virologist I met, with Ed Dubovi, with Danny Balasuria, Jim McLaughlin. Well, Peter Timoney published a very nice paper on the Equine Veterinary Journal, if I remember, in the 70s, about an outbreak of Laughing Eel in horses. It generally is a small ruminant virus, and which is a feature of the Scottish area, Ireland, but probably can come a little bit south. And distribution very similar to West Nile virus, same lesions. I think they were talking about a striking necrosis of Purkinje cells in that paper, but don't quote me on this. My memory is fading. Japanese encephalitis, believe it or not, we had two episodes of Japanese encephalitis detected in Europe in the last 20 years. One was they were all in birds, if I recall, and one was in Belgium in the early 2000s, another one was another communication. But we don't have it endemically in Europe. Tick-borne encephalitis, that's a big deal. My hometown Trieste, which where medicine is free and everything is good, because we got the efficiency of the former Austro-Hungarian Empire, and of course I'm kidding, everybody's efficient. The nice thing in Europe is that, if you get sick, someone's gonna take care of you sooner or later. You don't know if the doctor's gonna be good, but hey, the system is there in place. And you can get free vaccination for tick-borne encephalitis. United States, I would have to pay pretty penny. But when I went for the foundation in Africa, I spent $500, box means dollar, $500 10 years ago for to get all the possible vaccines, which were not particularly useful because Nairobi was a wonderful, clean, safe place, much safer than several American cities. So here is the striking across cerebral contingency. Tick-borne encephalitis. Be careful. That's an important disease that starts below the Alps and is all Middle European. I don't know how much works in the Balkan, but lots of wilderness in the Balkan, so I assume maybe coming down here. Then there is moral valley encephalitis flavivirus, prominent diffuse cerebrocortical necrosis in some cases. Then Kunjin flavivirus encephalitis, these two in Oceania, Africa, in Australia, where you know they act a little bit like West Nile virus. There are several other flaviviruses that are present in Europe, but they don't affect horses. Like Uzutu, as I mentioned, it's important, it's well studied in Vienna by Professor Vesselbock, I think, but they kill crows and other birds, they don't go to horses or to our domestic species, which is good. There is chikungunya. Chikungunya doesn't go to our domestic animals, but will hurt you. There was an episode of chikungunya a few years ago around Parma near Milan. And, you know, gives you encephalitis, but also decrease your bone density, because for some mechanism, there is also, it affects joints and bones. Just to tell you that the list is incomplete, because we are dealing mainly now with viruses that affect our equine species for the moment. You never know what's going on in the future, you know. Distribution of tick-borne encephalitis. See? Sorry, Yugoslavia. All map. Or all Serbia. Right? And I should have more recent pictures, but this is a courtesy of the Faculty of Bern, Dr. Overman in particular, where you can see here the cerebellar necrosis, the necrosis of Purkinje cells, remember? Red neuron, frase memorativa, sentence to remember, red is dead. You see a blue neuron, it's being manipulated. If you see a red neuron and shrunken, it's true necrosis or apoptosis. And then classic suggestive perivascular infiltration and gliosis. Japanese, horses, humans, and pigs, and possibly a few other species, can cause abortion in pigs. This picture is not pathognomonic for Japanese encephalitis abortion, because any pig that will abort will have this presentation. This could be anything, could be leptos, medi, anything. They start dying, you know, they start dying, and then eventually you have the last one, which is fresh, because the agent walks through the placentas, apparently, progressively. And we have this guy, probably a different subspecies, around our Lesiu lakes, and the Nycticoras, so the night heron, that's an Asian version, but we have a similar cousin of this species around our vet school. Juvenile form and adult, beautiful. They show up in the evening, start fishing. All the other are day birds during the day, you know, get in the sun. This guy, don't see them during the day. In the evening, crepuscular bird, but is with hematophagic diptera, mosquito type of insects, is one of the birds which is involved in the cycle of these Asian flaviviruses. And this from a C.L. Davis Foundation seminar, that's from a Wednesday Slide conference of the Bruce Williams group. They invite me to comment, and it's an Australian case. I wish I could acknowledge the author of the owner of the slides. I think it's the same that published the moral valley encephalitis lesion paper on Journal of Veterinary Diagnostic Investigation. So go to see that paper, it's a nice paper. And you see in this case, the inflammation is particularly florid. And if you tell me, can you differentiate this from West Nile virus, I wouldn't be able without molecular pathology. Alpha viruses, we don't have them in Europe. And interestingly, they're rather recent viruses, so they don't have millions of years, apparently, what my friend's virology expert in paleovirology told me. They're more recent. Rabies is an ancient virus. This one are more recent. And actually, I've been providing paraffin blocks with positive specimens in South America because my South American friend are looking for this infection in South America because they think they have this togaviridae alpha virus. It's a panencephalomyelitis. Interestingly, the virus also goes to the heart, inducing myocardial necrosis. So in the past, all the cases of histrionic encephalitis, that where we suspect we had the famous brain-heart syndrome, where, you know, like you get shot in the head and then you may develop a heart lesion. In human pathology, the so-called brain-heart syndrome. Tough to believe at the beginning, but there are some papers about it. So instead, the myocardial necrosis is due to direct cytopathic effect of histeric encephalitis. And also, believe it or not, it infects the smooth muscle of stomach, intestine, and also urinary blood. And there is also a little bit of hepatopathy. And also, which is not here, I don't know why I forgot about it, it goes to the interstitial cells in the kidney, you'll see. So, Culizeta melanura with the classic tail stripes, melan, black, uro, tail, caudal part. The virus, horse with severe clinical signs, depressed. If there would be a walk here, it would be head pressing. This could be anything. Could be a liver disease, Taylor disease, you know, a brain edema due to something else. And why did I put a pheasant? Because if it gets into your pheasant population, especially pheasant farms, I saw you got quite a few guinea fowls here along the way. So that kind of gallinaceous bird, but pheasant in particular, will wipe them out. Pennsylvania, a colleague of mine examined a farm, 300 animals, pretty much 90% encephalic and with encephalitis and death. Wish I had those specimens. So, when you talk about neuronophagia, well, that is a neuronophagia. Perivascular infiltrates, again, you see no plasma cells. Lymphocytes, one macrophage. Normal neuron, you see the nasal substance. Look at these glial cells of this neutrophil. Pretty much they're jumping on this neuron. This is what Dr. Cummings, God bless him, one of my mentors at Cornell University, great people, I had to quote them. Alexander De La Hunter, still around. Brian Summer, still around possibly for many years. And unfortunately, we lost Dr. Cummings in the mid-90s. Dr. Cummings, great neuropathologist and neuroanatomist, like the other two, was able to, he said, you know, that's a great example of cell violence. Neuronophagia. So, generally I use the term satellitosis when they go around, but I use neuronophagia personally only when they jump on the neuron. Details, not particularly important. And look at this. I swear that my screen is nice and clear. There is no background stain, there is no greenish color, so blame the projector, okay? So, you see, like in rabies, not as goodly as in rabies, but there is more virus than brain. Neurons, fibers, so very easy diagnosis. And in this case, you want to collect the brainstem because that's routine, but you'll find the virus in the cortex as well. So the cortex is good for rabies, it's good for histrionic encephalitis. Are you going to collect the cortex for West Nile virus? No, good. See, the virus detection putting evidence projections of neurons, I think. Neutrophils, a disease with quite a bit of neuronal necrosis, so quite a few neutrophils. euchromatic astrocytes with indented nucleus. Anytime you got brain edema, astrocytes start become hypertrophy and maybe hyperplastic, and the nucleus get bigger. Check always for membrane, nuclear membrane indentation. No specific change. Glial nodules. This is a camelid. That's an alpaca. Okay? Alpacas get diseases of cattle, get diseases of horses, and get all the arboviruses. In alpacas, we found West Nile, Easter equine encephalitis, rabies, equine herpes virus 1. We found BVD. We found blue tongue, and a few others. Poor guys, being isolated in the Andes at 5,000 meters for all their lives, what we do, we take them, we drop them in a flatland, surrounded by horses, cattle, sheep, and goats that have been selected for many years to deal with horrible diseases. What's happened? They get anything. So, and also, I never publish it, but I still have the pictures and maybe the slides. Equine varteritis. A Canadian sent me some slides of an outbreak of something that looked like EVA in llamas in the mid-90s. It was EVA, or an EVA-like virus. Very interesting. Anyway, and then, occasionally, that's rare, in addition to this all this encephalic mess, you'll find vascular necrosis. And this particular feature of a disease that I didn't have the privilege to study, because I didn't have natural case of it, only slides. Venezuelan encephalitis, so it's of the group of Eastern, Western, it's particularly associated with episode of vascular necrosis, just for your record. If I found something like this in the brain, I wouldn't think about this disease, I would think about EHV1 mainly, but that's the case. And look at the heart. Myocarditis, interstitial, and look at the antigen within the cardiocyte, which are undergoing necrosis. So what in the past was considered brain heart syndrome, now we know is direct cytopathy effect of the Easter equine encephalitis virus on the cardiocytes. And the smooth muscle of the intestine or the stomach, look at this. Infecting multifocally the smooth muscle cell. Interesting, very interesting. And then the interstitium. The tubules, the interstitial cells. You know the interstitium of the kidney? It looks boring, but it's not. There are fibroblasts. There are some smooth muscle cells, if I recall. And also there are antigen-presenting cells. So at least what you see here that looks like spindly cells, stellate cells, maybe all fibroblasts, is not. There are also antigen-presenting cells. The kidney is not only an interesting place to study because there are tubular infectious diseases, bacterial and viral, but also interstitium is pretty much pick up quite a bit of antigen. For instance, interstitium or pig kidney, you can find PRRS virus, you can find circovirus. So in this case of Easter equine encephalitis, this horse, in addition to the brain virus, in addition to the smooth muscle virus detection, there was also some interstitial cell, clearly antigen-presenting cells, stellate. They contain antigen also. they contain this antigen with triple E alpha virus. Calocantile, again, nice scheme of the disease. Carlos, great for these things and many others. So again, we got a virus like rabies, is all over the place. There should be a few other dots here. It is more cranial, but also you can find it here. And then cross section, pretty much gray matter, but also white matter. So, safe to diagnose. You'll see quite a few neutrophils. Histopathology is great to detect a lesion, direct diagnosis towards certain disease, but try to confirm it with molecular diagnostic. At the same time, don't let the system impose you only molecular diagnosis. So be always a protagonist of the diagnostic process. Very important. Be the case coordinator. Everything starts from here, you send it out, and then everything comes to you and then you make a diagnosis. Remember, your DVM, which means 5 to 6 years of sweat and blood. Then, majority of you has got a PhD, other 3 to 5 years. Plus, many of you will have a specialty. Doesn't matter, British, Royal, College, European, these are other 3 to 5 years. So, you are the depositaries of the science that allowed you to detect postmortem and in biopsies these diseases. So you should be the case coordinator of the case. Don't split, don't balkanize the diagnostic process. Allow me this fine joke, okay? So you are the guy in charge of the postmortem diagnostic process. No dispersion information. And then pheasants like to be horses. The same lesions that you find in the brain, the smooth muscle, in birds, you find them in the horses, you find them in birds. That's a pheasant. Look at how permissive the pheasant tissues are. Purkinje cells, the cerebellum, looks like a neuron-specific analysis state. No, it's the virus playing hooligan with this neuron. And then here, this perivascular expansion. Ooh, in the first paper of IEEE, I was able to find the virus within neutrophil and macrophages within the circulation. So it shows, as shown experimentally in rodent models, if you believe them, that the virus from the blood vessel passes the hematoencephalic barrier and got to infect the neurons. EHV1 will be a totally different pathogenetic mechanism. Borna is, there is a small group of people that study Borna, very interesting disease. A Middle European disease, is a polyencephalomyelitis. And it looks like a lymphoma of the brain, because I don't know any other disease except tumor, so lymphoma, lymphosarcoma of the meninges, or Borna that can induce this thick infiltration of lymphocytes. So, big coughs. And the virus, with a good antibody, these are slides I received from University of Berlin, and Achengruber, Professor Achengruber, and the cytoplasm is loaded, and the fibers are loaded with virus. Look at this. I remember the first Borna studies, different antibodies, were just, you know, a few cells here and there, especially the neurons with the yoest Degen bodies, the one that red intranuclear, when they're put together look like a coffee bean occasionally. And actually this disease has been studied by Dr. Yoest, that was one of the big German pathologists, that was also the, and there were several Italians and Northern Italians and Balkanian pathologists that went to study pathology from Dr. Yoest, and one of them was Professor Jurak. You all know Professor Jurak, right? From Zagreb, that then was shot in 1945 because diagnosed those. He was both veterinary pathologist and he was also both human pathologist, veterinary pathologist. And they asked me to evaluate the skulls of some Polish officers, and he diagnosed them, well, he's gunshot. So that was blaming the Russians. And the Russians didn't like that. So sent the order to the governments here in 1945 to execute Professor Jurak. And now in Zagreb, from 1992, there is a comparative pathology symposium that is dedicated to Professor Jurak. That was one of the best pupils of Professor Yoest, which was the most important neuropathologist in Europe between 1800 and the first 1900, that, you know, studied this important disease. So, and then later on, they were able to detect the disease in shrews. Shrews are little insectivorous. In the Mediterranean language, they're called toporagno, which means spider mouse. Shrews in English, the genus, just to speak international language, is Crucidura. They, little guys, eat insects pretty feisty, very short life, 1-2 years, less than mice. But apparently there are virus factors for boner. And that's a veterinary pathology paper of Dr. Puerger and collaborators. Demonstration of boner disease virus, antigen tissue of shrews by immunohistochemistry. Look at this, perivascular, skin, it's all over. They're in perfect balance with the virus. So that's apparently the reservoir for this tick-borne disease. Asinine, looks like a rhinencephalon here, I don't want to be mistaken. More cells that are heavily infected. So, looks like, hey, this, if this would be a cow, this would be a cow, that would be a, the distribution would suggest a persistent infection of BVD. It is a shrew carrying Borna disease, so that's the culprit. So anytime you handle a shrew, well, don't handle it, let it go, okay? You can start collecting shrew in the Balkans to see if you got Borna. And again, Carlo, this Carlo drawing with the distribution of the virus, you see that since that the distribution is rhinencephalon, and then perihippocampal, cerebellar, and brainstem, thalamic. Not much spinal cord studies. I'm not saying that the virus is not there. We should ask people that study Borna disease as a, for a living. EHV1, that's the most important equine virus. Why? It's all over. There is no vaccine. There is the vaccine for the genital form, where you need to give the mare 5 shots to have some results. You can have a maiden mare, even if she's vaccinated, she may abort. And there is no protection for the neurologic form. And if in the 90s and 80s, the people were telling you that the virus, the neurologic outbreak of EHV1 occurs once every 10 years, from 1992 on, we started observing this outbreak very frequently. And now on ProMed, which is the Infectious Disease Specialist Network, every few weeks there is an outbreak of EHV1. There is not much you can do about it except biosecurity measures, because there is no vaccine against the neurologic form. There are not many herpes virus vaccine around that protect against infection. There is only one against the human herpes virus. And let me remind you about the forms. In the past, there were 3 forms. In 2000, we identified a 4th form, which is very rare. So abortion and stillbirth. Remember, abortion storm, EHV1. Sporadic abortion, EHV1 and EHV4. Why is EHV4 not diagnosed much? Because you need for the isolation, when virus isolation was more frequent than PCR, you need equine cell lines, equine fetal cell line, and the virus grows slowly. So you can isolate EHV4 in a fetal long cell line after 4 or 5 days, so you need to wait. EHV1 is a hooligan. You can use any possible cell line, baby hamster, renal fetal mouse, there are several cell lines that works fine. You get some mice, immunocompetent mice, inoculate them with EHV1, you develop disease. In fact, there are you do trial on these little animals. So EHV1, EHV4. EHV1, respiratory disease in young horses. EHV4, much more respiratory disease in young horses. EHV1, abortion, and especially abortion storms. EHV4, sporadic abortion. It's more a respiratory virus. Benign respiratory disease, as I mentioned, 2nd form. Then there is the ischemic myelencephalopathy, which is the one we'll discuss here. And then don't forget that there are some EHV1 viruses, rarely, you may not have seen them, that they infect your horse, especially young horses. You go to bed, the horse is fine in the stable. The following day, the horse is dead. You open up the chest of this horse, and you see lesions like in African horse sickness. The lungs are heavy, wet, and then the chest is full of serum. You will see the lesion. Really scary, but rare. Very rare form. I want you to recognize it. The virus with electron microscopy, classic presentation. This is a picture, it's very historical. I got it from Peter Timoney, Professor Timoney from Ireland, Kentucky, 1961. Several of you were not born here. Healthy foal, mare with paralysis. And then classic late-term abortion, you know, classic late-term abortion, because EH1 will kill your foal, not much at the beginning of the pregnancy, then you waste less time and less money. It kills the foal even the last few days of pregnancy. It's a late abortion. So you lose a foal after 11 months. It's a tragedy. So you wait a year of your life, and then the last few days, this guy comes and, you know, induce vasculitis of the uterus, placental detachment, fetal infection, and you got a dead foal in your hand, you got a foal at term in your hands. Took this picture of a case I had with Professor Del Hunter. It's probably 95. You see, the gross lesion, this spinal cord in cross section, highlight the pathogenesis of the disease. Along blood vessels, not much gray matter, like in West Nile virus, but white matter blood vessels. But don't dare to make this distinction. This is just something you do with your friends in a meeting like this, and in the necropsy room with your student. Could be, you know, West Nile virus generally will have hemorrhages in the gray matter or nothing. EH1 generally will have hemorrhage along the blood vessels because of vasculopathy with thrombosis. But don't trust. Generally, you don't see anything. And often, West Nile will be in the white matter sometimes, and vice versa for EH1. So, gross pathology in this case, just for fun. This couldn't be even a good board examination slide. Could be. But to the residents, to the future colleagues, I would have to ask differential diagnosis. Here, the differential, here the diagnosis would be myencephalopathy or myencephalitis with thrombosis and hemorrhages. Differential diagnosis, EHU1, number one, but also West Nile virus, Escherichia encephalitis, or any other alpha viral encephalitis, and even sarcocystis neurona. And if someone put rabies, I'm sure that I never saw rabies doing this, but I have to accept it because rabies can be associated with hemorrhage. Okay? Right. I would like to say more about it, but it was a period of time in which they were obliging us to put at the board examination to select one agent. I mean, didn't make any sense. Anyway, a picture I took with Professor Della Fanta, the microscope, that's a Kodachrome being converted to digital, and all the merit goes to Professor Della Fanta to detect this beautiful blood vessel with thrombosis. Look at this, thrombosis, endothelial cells start, you know, getting a little bit sick here. There is even chromatin margination. You don't see inclusion bodies in the myelencephalopathic form of EH1, but this one is even start to look like. And then perivascular lymphocytes and macrophages. Do you see any plasma cell here? Again, equine viruses in the brain, virus in the brain of horses, no plasma cells. All the other species, plenty. No explanation. And then this will cause ischemia. And then everything that depends from that blood vessel, generally like a triangle, like a cone, will be dead. So here in cross-section, Malaysia, you see Gitter cells, spheroids, nice spheroids, myelomacrophages. And immunohistochemically, this is not an antibody complex vasculitis like FIP. EVA, equine viral enteritis, EHV1, I did that in the 90s. I didn't detect any antigen antibody complexes. guilty that he didn't publish it, but word of Balkanian gentleman, okay? So, but there is not much virus, but when you see it, in Santa you see only one endothelial cells after examining three or four sections. That's the reason, because you want to go with histology and PCR to diagnose the disease. You find the virus within the endothelium. Look at this, stretching endothelial cells with the antigen. Myocytes and maybe pericytes, lymphocytes and macrophages, no plasma cells. And then in cross-section, a similar blood vessel. That's a venule, this is an artery, segmentally distributed. And here we need to give credit to the British investigators. That's my case, this is a case of the United States. But the people that really took this virus seriously, in addition to Kentucky, so Americans, in fact, the virus was discovered in Kentucky in the 30s, late 20s. I wish I would remember the people I had in one of my old slides. But at the Manuel Altras in Newmarket, where I was there as a visiting fellow in 92, the group of investigators, which was comprised of Catherine Whitwell, Tony Blunden, and Ken Smith, did a lot to clarify the pathogenesis of this disease. So they study experimental infections, natural cases of abortions, and myelencephalopathy. They also show plenty of antigen within the nose of these horses. And this was in collaboration also with the virologist of the animal interest. So the British did quite a bit of input to the research in this field. It was a very interesting period of time, the early 90s, for the study of this disease. Also, interesting experimental infection in ponies and also horses. And I had the privilege to spend more than 6 months with these people, and we had a blast, and I remember my English time there as wonderful days around Newmarket. So, and this is the distribution H1. You see, the brainstem is always a safe haven. So you will see that few section of brainstem, don't forget to examine the rest of the brain, will give you satisfaction, at least regarding the histologic lesion. And you see white matter, some gray matter, also cortex, not much I would say, but also cortex, not much in the cerebellum. And then there are exceptions, you know. Again, Professor Cantile, University of Pisa, nice schema of virus distribution. Then, that's a disease of multiple species, it's a porcine herpes virus, but you can see it also in you see also in sheep, goats, cats, dogs, cattle, and believe it, in horses. There is that great paper of Professor Van den Ing on a European journal of the 80s, where he described this outbreak of Augeschi disease in horses. Augeschi disease in Europe, pseudorabies in the United States. Which are the four names of pseudorabies? A disease with four names. I like Augeschi because it reminds me of my professor, and then, you know, the Hungarians were in the past, probably also now, great virologists. You know, there are three famous Hungarian virologists discovered those three major diseases. So pseudorabies virus, why cause pseudorabies in the United States, and then in Europe cause Augeschi, which is the same, just different names. And there are also two names of the disease. One is mad itch, because these animals, dogs, cats, especially dogs and guinea pigs, when in natural infected, experimental infected, they start scratching themselves like they would have the most worst case of mange. And then there is also, in some old books, we are talking about 1800, was called bulbar paralysis. So four names for one disease. But United States, say Augeschi, they look at you and say, unless there is someone that really knows pathology. So it's a virus that is not present in the farm porcine population in the United States, but is spread in Europe. For instance, in Italy, there is still Augeschi disease, unfortunately, but it's widely present in the feral porcine population in wild boars. So classic thing that your dog, when he's hunting wild boars, can catch is being trained with pigs or hunting wild boars, they can die, not necessarily of trauma induced by the wild pig or the wild boar, but they can die of encephalitis due to pseudorabies. We see quite a few cases every year in our institution. It's shed particularly by youngsters, and it can, in piglets, it can cause nati mortality, so perinatal mortality, abortion, with multifocal necrosis in the lung, in the liver, and also in other organs, and also bronchiectasis pneumonia in piglets. There is a vaccination for pigs, which unfortunately is also used for dogs, but doesn't work. Virus, classic. And anybody saw a case of pseudorabies in a dog or in a cat? The clinical presentation. Amazing, huh? So, especially in cats, it's incredible. In certain European countries, or in other countries, they catch it, our cats and dogs, because during the domestic slaughtering, there's generally a cloud of kittens that jump on the blood that comes from the pig, semi-feral kittens, you know, and then sometime later they see them with one pupil which is bigger than the other, they're slobbering like they would have eaten a toxic caterpillar, and eventually they die with severe encephalitic signs. So there is this nice publication of Dr. Van den Ing on digestive disease in horses. I don't remember how they got it, but so I show you the disease in other horses because I never saw a case. So perivascular infiltration, lots of, sometimes you see minimal lesions, like in cats, a few glial cells, and you have a dead cat. Sometimes the encephalitis is florid, and in this manuscript of Professor Van den Ing, if I recall, there were very florid signs. Same thing in cattle, or severe encephalitis, or very mild lesions. That's a cat. That's the only thing I found, this cat from north of Italy. Actually, the person that read the slides before me didn't see the lesion. Well, I was lucky maybe because my ricotta was more than what she got. Gliosis, but you see, there is these cells that start having chromatin margination fragmentation, and with a little bit of imagination, but not much, you can see that there is inclusion bodies information. In pigs and dogs, sometimes you can find decent inclusions. The classic presentation is my lesion, perivascular infiltrate, and a few neutrophils. And then you do your PCR, in the past, virus isolation, or inoculation of a guinea pig or a rabbit. We don't do these things anymore. But that was when I was a vet student, this was one of the gold standard. Inoculation of a experimental animal. We don't do that anymore, okay? And that's a picture of Professor Vara of San Ministro Chemistry via the C.L. Davis Foundation. Very lucky shot because generally there is not so much antigen in a pig. Remember that equine infection anemia, which is a recurrent disease, Europe is free, and then suddenly a vet in Ireland decided to reuse the needle and spread the disease again, that from Ireland also moved to Italy. So it's always swamp fever, which is also the other famous name of equine infectious anemia. It's a disease that is there, ready to strike again. And occasionally, it induces a mild to moderate, occasionally severe, encephalitis. The virus is detectable in a few macrophages. And then it presents with anemia, glomerulonephritis, leptomeningoencephalomyelitis, hemosiderosis of liver and spleen, which induce lymphadenomegaly and hepatomegaly. And you can find this the RNA virus in a few scattered cells. And in this manuscript of Ox and collaborators, you see there is in the cerebral cortex, the coronal section, the frontal lobe in this pony, experimental, so there was some changes, discoloration, and a little bit of malacia of the tissue. And then histologically, I never saw a case like this, it's experimental. I would say it would be safe to call this slide granulomatose, because like in EPM, you can see macrophages and also multinucleated giant cells. So, experimentally, it's got a pretty serious presentation. Naturally, there are just a few lymphocytes and plasma cells, just to mention. Never saw it. Just I'm reporting you what there is in the literature. And some FIP slides, this brain, you see progressive infiltration with lymphocytes and macrophages, like you would see also in other immunodeficiency virus patients, like cats or humans with HIV. And here's the RNA in a few cells. And then there are these diseases that we know because there are studies by the orbivirus specialist. They've been described recently quite a bit in Israel, and they're called encephalosis because apparently there are not many changes in the brain, and they can produce encephalopathy. I assume there is brain edema. They describe some encephalitis cases, although I didn't find many pictures online, and then there is also abortion. So I'm just reporting what I saw at meeting in the literature, because I didn't have a case. Encephalosis. Orbiviruses, so same family of blue tongue and especially African horse sickness. And why do I show you a liver in a neuropathology presentation? Well, because, and why in this virus section? Because some people think that Taylor's disease, the serum hepatitis, when you have so much necrosis, I can lift up the liver and like a dish rag. Dish rag is what you use to dry up your plates before the automatic washing era. How many of you were in the army that use a lot of dish rag for everything? So that's me holding the liver. Don't remember, it was Cornell or the Bolton Center. And here is a cross-section picture of my colleague, Dr. Rebecca, University of Pennsylvania, show you the massive necrosis. And let me tell you one thing. Everybody will tell you that the liver of Taylor's disease, I like to call it Taylor disease for some good reason that I will explain to you in a second. Everybody thinks that the liver of Taylor's disease is flaccid, like in a severely autosomal liver. But if you are lucky enough, like it's happened to me a couple of times, to open up a fresh horse that's been just euthanized because the severe neurologic clinical signs where the necrosis is very acute and still severe but still progressing through the lobules, the liver, instead of being flaccid, will be actually turgid. So there is a phase that the liver, like in all the acute viral diseases of the liver, like in the pest of the goose, in the pest of the duck, this is a virus that induces hepatic necrosis. There is a phase in which the liver is turgid, and then the necrosis, it's so massive that it collapses. Why did I put it on the neurologic diseases and amongst the viral diseases? Because some people think that there is a virus, maybe a Peggy virus, inducing this massive necrosis. I'm not against it, always thought about it. And so that's the reason because I put it here. And what you see in the brain of these horses, even if the horse is autolyzed, you can diagnose it, because there will be brain edema, so extreme pallor, dilatation of perivascular spaces, and here in detail, perivascular spaces, neuronal vacuolation, you know, increased Virchow Robin spaces. That's an old horse because there is lipofusion. And then Alzheimer type 2 cells, forming couple, triplets, quadruplets, so astrocyted together. And then if you perform a GFIP stain that should highlight these astrocytes, it's mild. They don't pick up much of the staining, so there is less expression. That was what I noted with brain edema. Best location, the neocortex. You can find it somewhere else, but neocortex in the horse is the best spot for brain edema. In ruminants, the white matter below the cortex. Llamas, alpacas, sheep and goats, sometimes cattle, and buckets. Horse cortex, like small animals. What's your diagnosis? If you want to buy a Ferrari in Belgrade, where do you go? Okay. Fortunately, we don't have in Europe these guys, which are super cute, but they're deadly for horses. Unfortunately, in Europe we have several non-endemic species. And we are talking about animals. I didn't want to open a political chapter, but we have gray squirrel. First, they were imported to England, then escaped England, and they're going now around, misplacing the original Shurus vulgaris. And then in Germany, some areas you got raccoons that will bring by his ascaris and other issues. And then, fortunately, we don't have these opossums, these marsupials, which are commonly present in the United States. They are in my garden. And they're nice guys. They don't do any harm. Actually, you can take them by the tail. You can move them around. I relocated generally in other gardens when I catch them. And other garden, not on my neighbors, but you know, bring them in the country, you know, around Baton Rouge. And the first time I saw them in Cornell, I read about them in the book. It was 1993. So I found this huge guy on top of the hill during a snowstorm. And this guy, when I was going to see him, the guy was coming to me very aggressive. So I said, I came back to my colleague and said, I saw a huge rat on the top of the hill there in the Cornell. So how was the rat? It was an opossum. So that was my first encounter with an opossum. Anyway, these guys are, they look very aggressive, but in reality they seldom bite. And they carry sarcocystis neurona, which they shed it. And unfortunately horses, when they assume these protozoan parasites, they may develop a fatal, very destructive encephalomyelitis. So I think that would be the time to stop for the moment, and then we can have a break, coffee break, the break within the time, maybe a bit shorter, and we can continue with protozoal diseases of the equine CNS. Is there any quick question? All right, you can also save them for later.